Ladies and gentlemen, may I now invite to the podium for the remarks our special guest, Mr. Lina Marie Baudel, Chief Secretary, Government of Liban.
Chairperson of the session, Chief Guest, Honorable Deputy Prime Minister, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I am privileged of having this opportunity to share some of my views with you. At the outset, I would like to take the opportunity to thank all of you for your active participation and contribution to make this conference a success. Last 6.5 days, you have created a platform for sharing practical and scientific aspects of implementing community-based adaptation for climate change. As I heard that, the meeting remained highly interactive, and you not only shared your views with the audience here, but shared views with, on a real-time basis with the outside community. I was briefed that the discussions were held and sharing of different methods took place for securing finance for local adaptation plans and programs, issues of institutional capacity building and mainstreaming of adaptation actions into local governance structures were discussed. Issues such as wealth and means for financing LDCs and reaching out to the most vulnerable communities were surfaced out during the deliberations. Deliberations also focused on how the private sectors and microfinances can be engaged and how the innovations are promoted for low-cost options to mitigate. Accounting of natural capital and ecosystem services, securing benefit for financing, adaptation strategies too, were enumerated during meetings. This is the summary of the meeting that transpired in the previous sessions and the field trips, as I was told. I believe that local community-based programs which promote traditional technologies and know-how can prove to be low-cost options for adaptation interventions. The recommendations of the 3 days conferences can be documented in a proceedings which will showcase a bunch of adaptation financing alternatives. I'm confident that the conference participants are taking back clear messages home, and that recommendations of the conferences provided additional opportunities to collaborate amongst us who are involved in the climate policy dialogues. The world we live today is more vulnerable than the world we have inherited from our parents in terms of climate consequences. People from the poorer region of the world are bearing heavy brunt of climate change catastrophes without their contribution to make this world more vulnerable. They don't have time to wait. People need immediate action. As Dr. Salim Ullah just mentioned a small incident when they have the field trip, just he mentioned about the people dancing when there were a traffic jam. In an adaptation field, we cannot ask people to dance and play and enjoy when they are exposed with high risk of life and livelihood. Not due to their actions and causes, but because of our actions and causes. Therefore, the urgent actions is warranted. plottings and recommendations of the conference will definitely help push forward to make a right decision on time. People at the villages have demonstrated us that implementing any adaptation and financing can be done in a cost-effective manner with a significant important results. Now it is our turn. We in the policy-making circle, we have access to the international forums and funds. We are influential in making national and international adaptation policies. We need to work together with due diligence. A great deal of unaccomplished task is ahead of us. I believe that our joint commitment and collaborative efforts to act together can lead us to a climate smart future. We have heard consistently about the need for the voices of developing worlds, the voices of local communities, to be better addressed the financing need of adaptation. However, the international climate funds mostly have been tendered to flow on mitigation actions. As per my knowledge, the percentage of the total financing to mitigation alone crosses 2/3 of the total funding. I believe that this international conference and succeeding discussions that may follow will pave the way for stronger financing options to the local adaptation actions. Nepal, even being a resource-constrained country, taking a heavy burden by allocating resources to reduce emissions, to promote green economy, and to better adaptation and also ensure stronger mitigation measures in case of need arises. Those measures are taken unilaterally and voluntarily, considering the common challenges the humanity faces due to climate change. But our capabilities are limited in comparison to the challenges and the risks we are exposed to. Please do not put further burdens to us in your Kathmandu declarations. For the enhanced funding, not as a charity, at the mercy of the people who enjoy luxury, but as a right of the people who suffered most. The recent accident in Khumbu icefalls have taken a precious life of our beloved brave Sherpas. The consequence of such accident to the overall tourism, economy, and livelihood of people in the remotest part of the world are great and heavy. The stakes are very high. Same accident in the developed world would have a negligible impact to their economy. The rate of retreating ice in the Himalayan is alarmingly high, exposing black rocks in place of beautiful ice in a decade ago. The rate of avalanches in that region is unimaginably with high frequencies. These all are because of the temperature rise, which was the result of the luxury of few days, people enjoying far away from the people who suffered most. Those who have been enjoying luxury are risking the life of the people, the poorest of the poor, at the other end of the earth without realizing it. It is urgent to make the people aware of the consequences of climate change and the risk and vulnerabilities to the people exposed to it. People in this part of the world need climate justice. It is their right to be compensated by the people who have made this world much riskier, not as a mercy or charity them to offer by the other's wishes. Temperature rise by 2 degrees in tropical region means temperature rise by at least 6 percentage points in the Himalayan region. As a result, the snow in the Himalayan region as a source of fresh water for almost 2 billion people would disappear in a few decades' time. We cannot afford it. We need urgent action. And a strong agreement with binding emissions cut to ensure not just above 1.5 degree temperature rise is warranted. We have to act resolutely, prudently, and in a responsible manner to ensure safer and better world. I would like to call upon the world community and the major contributors of the pollution to the present world to present in a responsible manner for the safer and secure future of all of us. We in Nepal have made policies and provisions to ensure at least 80% of funds reaches to the needy people at the local level. Though we need to review how much we have been successful to achieve this target, but I believe that such policy initiatives on the part of receiving end would definitely empower the local community and make them step forward to get access over the funds and strengthen their capabilities to respond for the adaptation governance. On the other hand, the international communities need to move forward for simplified process to access the funds by the vulnerable countries and communities without hazards. The funds earmarked this time is barely sufficient to meet the challenges ahead of us. With this message, I would like to thank all the participants, organizers and sponsors, scientists and my colleagues, and especially Mrs. Cristina Figueres for your active participation in making this conference a success. Thank you very much for your active participation and strong commitment. I wish all of you a safe and pleasant journey back home. I hope we'll have more time to work together for our common cause and common future. Thank you.